Hey, welcome to What the Heaven. My name's Patrick, and this is the place where it's good to ask questions. A lot of us don't feel safe to ask people questions about our faith, about Christianity, about Jesus, about the Bible, and that's what this channel's all about. So before we begin, if there's anything that you have questions about after this video, or if there's something completely random that you want to ask me, shoot me a DM, add something in the comments. I would love to make a video answering your question. Now, this video is a response to questions that I've been getting all week, and it's this. What are Christians supposed to do because of the murder of George Floyd? What are we supposed to do because of the riots and the protests and the clashes with police? What is the Christian's role in all of this? I'm excited to tackle this today, but before we begin, if you wouldn't mind looking down at the bottom of the screen, there's a little red square that will let you subscribe. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button and we'll get started. Thanks. If you have a Bible next to you, pick a random page. Pick any spot, any book, anywhere that you want to look at. There's a pretty good chance that whoever wrote that passage was living under oppression. The entire biblical narrative is a story of people who were oppressed, either socially or officially by a government. Look at the Israelites in the Old Testament. They were occupied by they were enslaved by the Egyptians, and then they were occupied by the Greeks, the Babylonians, the Persians, the Egyptians again, and then finally, and maybe worst of all, the Roman Empire. God begins the Ten Commandments this way. He doesn't say, here's all of the lists, here's what you're supposed to do. He says, I am the God who brought you out of Egypt, out of slavery. The Jewish narrative is one about escaping oppression. And anywhere in the Gospels in the New Testament, you are reading something written by someone who is living under occupation by the Roman Empire. The church has a mixed history when it comes to slavery. British Quakers, they were the ones who led the charge against slavery in England. John Wesley, who started the Methodists, he called slavery the sum of all villainies. And slaves escaping the American South, they were able to stay in churches during the Underground Railroad when they were trying to escape slavery in the South. But the church, we have to admit, has also been on the wrong side of history. A specific denomination, I don't want to call them out, they formally supported apartheid in South Africa. The Methodists, like my denomination, the Church of Christ, we split because some people, many people, wanted to continue the culture of slavery. And we're all aware of the scriptures in the Bible that are used to support slavery. American churches should be the first group in the world to admit that oppression exists. After all, our Savior was murdered by soldiers from an occupying country. They were taking over our Holy Land. Oppression continues until people are willing to acknowledge that oppression exists. It's good to talk about ethics and strategies and how the government is behaving and how the police is behaving and how the protesters are behaving. That is good. But all of those decisions, all of those discussions should not happen until we acknowledge that oppression exists on a systemic scale in America.
I am Quark, son of Keldar, and I have come to answer the challenge of Gagor, son of whatever.
I'm a Trekkie, and I love being a Trekkie. If you don't know what a Trekkie is, you're probably a very normal person. A Trekkie is a person who's a fan of Star Trek, and I love Star Trek because of what it says about humanity. In Star Trek, if there is a war between people who are of the same species, of people who live on the same planet, it's not just called a war. It's called a civil war. In the future, when there are aliens everywhere, the idea of humanity fighting amongst itself is so weird. It makes no sense because they have so much in common. That's not sci-fi. That's the truth. The only TV show that Martin Luther King Jr. let his kids watch at night was Star Trek. Why? Because Nichelle Nichols was a black woman on the bridge of the Enterprise. Star Trek put a black woman on the bridge in the 1960s. That was revolutionary. In the 90s, Star Trek put a single black dad as the lead of its biggest, newest franchise. Also, Star Trek Deep Space Nine is the best Star Trek. If you disagree with me, you're wrong. Also, Star Trek Discovery is not Star Trek. Don't even get me started on that. Star Trek, though, like God, knows that everyone on this planet is one. As Christians, we know that this is true. The Bible says that God created us in His image. We are the image of God. We are the reflection of who He is. Now, I don't know if that means that we literally look like Him. I don't know if God has two arms. I don't know how that works. But God created us to reflect His image. My son's name is Holden. And yes, that's a allusion to The Catcher in the Rye, which also makes it an allusion to The Expanse, the best show on television right now. And Holden, he's 4 years old. And like a lot of four-year-olds, he likes Pokemon, he's very loud, and he likes crashing cars into, other cars that he's crashing into. Holden's my son, and he bears my image. If you don't like Holden, if you hate Holden, you hate me. But hate's a strong word. If you think Holden is lesser than other people, you think I'm lesser than other people too. If you hate other people, other cultures, other color skin, you don't just hate them. You hate the person whose image they were created in. The way we treat God's children shows what we think about God, because we are all His children. And if we are Christian, the Bible says that we are clothed in Christ. When God looks at us, he doesn't see race. When God looks at us, He sees Jesus. If you oppress somebody, if you allow oppression to happen, you oppress Jesus. And oppression will continue until we admit that there is oppression in our neighborhoods and in our cities and in our thoughts. Everybody is angry. I live in Asia, people here are angry. In New Zealand, they're angry. In America, they're angry. And when we get angry, we want someone to blame. We want to point our fingers and say, they are wrong. Some people think the protesters are wrong. Some people think the looters, the people who are rioting, are wrong. Some people think the entire government is wrong. Some people think the police are wrong. Some people think that everything in the world is wrong. We want to blame Black Lives Matter. We want to blame Antifa. We want to blame the President of the United States. We can't change any of these people. Now, I 100% support the protesters. I 100% believe Black Lives Matter. And I 100% believe that the majority of Americans do too. But here's what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid that if I'm pointing the finger at the people who are wrong, they're pointing the finger right back at me. I'm afraid that nothing will change if all we do is point fingers. Here's what I also believe. If you want to point a finger at yourself. This is the only person that I can change. It starts with me allowing God to change myself. Now, I don't know how to stop violence, but I do think that's the first way to stop oppression. It starts with us changing our lives, acknowledging our bias, and working for peace. As a white guy, that means acknowledging that I won the lottery. My skin color, the shade of melanin on my epidermis, if you want to be like DC Talk, allows me certain privileges that virtually no one else on earth gets. I am lucky, and if I don't admit that, I allow oppression to continue. In my series on the afterlife, we've been discussing that the point of Christianity, the goal of this life, is not for people on earth to go to heaven. It's actually for the people on earth to make earth more like heaven. That's what Jesus prayed for, and that's our goal for life, that earth will be more like heaven. In Revelation 21 and 22, we see this. We see our destiny. God, He comes to us, He lives with us, and He is our sustainer, and we all live in a glorious city, a new creation. And in this city, the Bible says, the nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. All of us will live together with God as our King and sustainer. We will live together without war, without judgment, without pain or hatred. But here's the coolest part. The point of the Christian life is that we don't have to wait to start new creation. Now, Paul wrote that new creation begins as soon as we are in Christ. We don't need to wait to die. We don't have to wait for the apocalypse to try to get rid of pain, hunger, and war. We can start that right now. And if you're an American, like myself, that means that we have to try to find the way to end systemic oppression and racism that has been the foundation of our country for 400 years. That means we confront our own biases, we confront our judgments, and we allow God to change the way we see everybody. If we can't solve this problem, nothing else matters. Thanks so much for watching. If you have any questions or want to bring up a new topic, please DM me or please add something into the comments below. I promise to make a video about it. I'll have another video up soon. If you die before the next video comes out, I want you to remember that Black Lives Matter.